The Prague Spring of 1968 proved to be one of the defining episodes of the Cold War, putting an end to both the reformist hopes of many, as well as the Soviet Union's era of peaceful coexistence. As our previous video on the 1956 Hungarian uprising explored, the Soviets were willing to use violence to maintain their hegemony over the Eastern Bloc. But Prague Spring was a reformist movement, not a revolution. So why was it so dangerous that the USSR deemed it necessary to invade a sovereign, ideologically allied nation? What was Prague Spring, and what were its effects on Czechoslovak society? I'm your host David, and today we are going to explore these questions and more in this first episode of a two-part documentary on the events of Czechoslovakia's Prague Spring. This is The Cold War. Like many key episodes of the Cold War, the story of the Prague Spring begins in the immediate aftermath of the Second World War. Before the war, during the interwar period, Czechoslovakia had arguably been one of Europe's most stable and consolidated democracies. In 1946, however, the Communist Party of Czechoslovakia, abbreviated the KSC, won its first election before seizing power in a coup d'etat in 1948 and establishing a one-party state aligned with the Soviet Union. We made a video about that a long time ago in a studio far, far away. In the wake of the coup, Czechoslovakia quickly became one of the most overtly Stalinist and oppressive regimes in the entire Eastern Bloc. Though many citizens did buy into the communist reconstruction plan for Czechoslovakia after the devastation of the war, this ultimately came at the expense of almost all civil liberties. As most Czechoslovaks had a shared experience of democracy still in recent memory, this was not an insignificant development. Simultaneously, the KSC's coup saw the Czechoslovak economy completely centralized and shifted from a capitalist structure to a planned socialist model. It would be Antonín Novotný, a devoted Stalinist as well as a founding member of Czechoslovakia's Communist Party in 1921, who would lead Czechoslovakia through the 1950s and 1960s, emerging as the KSC's first secretary in 1953. By the late 1950s, however, dissatisfaction with the status quo was already beginning to emerge. Czechoslovakia's centrally planned economy was facing huge challenges, with stagnating wages and agricultural output at lower levels than during the interwar period. By the early 1960s, these issues had become endemic. National income actually declined in 1963, while by 1965, Czechoslovakia's national income was only 1.9% higher than in 1960. Meanwhile, in the West, and even in some other Eastern Bloc countries, growth was much higher as post-war modernization continued. These economic issues were compounded by the fact that Novotný's government was highly centralized around a small cadre of elites. For example, the National Party apparatus had only 8,500 employees, and only 750 people ran the party at the very center. This was, of course, undemocratic, a necessary characteristic of Stalinist regimes, but more importantly, this exacerbated particular social changes in the Czechoslovak population that had been taking place since the end of the war. The main issue in question was the rising level of education among Czechoslovaks. When the KSC established its hegemony in 1948, the government was led by people who were relatively amateur and lacking in real qualifications. This characteristic of the system lingered throughout Novotný's rule. However, his centralization of power meant that there were minimal opportunities for the educated classes to penetrate the bureaucracy and achieve a higher standard of living relative to their skills. As a result, many were beginning to lose faith in the communist system. Given the lack of mobility for educated Czechoslovaks within the communist system, many instead turned to criticism of the Novotný regime. Writers such as Jan Beneš, Ludvík Vaculík, Jan Pruščanská, and Ivan Klíma were all sanctioned by Novotný for their dissident writings. These writings were distributed similarly to samizdat publications in the Soviet Union, where copies were made by hand and then passed around. This allowed them to bypass the regime's censorship protocols and became widely read as a result. Their work reflected not only dissatisfaction with the economic status quo, but also the fact that personal freedoms had been reneged on so viciously with few tangible benefits in return. Even members of the Slovak minority within the KSC itself were asking for more autonomy to take matters into their own hands and move away from the stringency of the Novotny regime. Such a dire economic and political situation required urgent action. As early as September 1964, Novotny's government was forced to make concessions to dissatisfied members of the KSC. A group of reformers, led by figures like Ota Šik, forced Novotny to adopt a new set of economic principles. Šik's suggestion was a switch from a command economy to a mixed economy. Although Novotny actually opposed this, he had little choice but to accept their demands, at least rhetorically. The reality was, however, that few of the reforms which were promised were actually implemented. The centralization of Czechoslovakia's institutions around the KSC was already too entrenched, and further changes would directly threaten Novotny's personal position among the powerful minority who supported his Stalinist policies. Novotny's deeply unpopular government hobbled on until 1967, when his leadership faced a more direct and unified challenge. Outside of politics, the Union of Czechoslovak Writers, led mostly by intellectuals and students, began to air their discontent more actively and more openly, suggesting reforms that would exempt literature from party censorship. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Novotny's response was an even harsher crackdown. In the political realm, this prompted a group of mostly Slovak reformers within the KSC to harshly criticize Novotny for acting like a dictator and ignoring the demands for change that had become unignorable by the late 1960s. These reformers were now led by the ethnically Slovak Alexander Dubček alongside the aforementioned Ota Šik. So, how did Novotny respond to the reformers' criticism? In secret, he got in touch with Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev and invited him to come to Prague in September in an attempt to help shore up his position. But Brezhnev refused. Though he was shocked by the extent of opposition to Novotny, he proclaimed, quote, "This is your affair. I shall not deal with the problems that have arisen in your country." Brezhnev was evidently disappointed that Novotny had allowed the situation to become so critical in Czechoslovakia, but at least in 1967, he was not willing to take any action to save the Novotny regime. In fact, he preferred Novotny's departure altogether, believing that it was the only way to settle the situation. With the convergence of Dubček's faction coming to the forefront inside the KSC, widespread popular discontent, and Brezhnev's tacit support, Czechoslovakia was poised for a change in leadership. By January 1968, these elements would culminate in exactly this outcome. The questions of how to reform Czechoslovak communism and who should lead the process were handed over to the Central Committee, resulting in a vote of no confidence in Novotny. He was swiftly demoted from first secretary of the KSC to the much less powerful position of president, with Dubček taking his place at the helm on January 5, 1968. Though Dubček's popularity was not unanimous, he became first secretary because the party was extremely split over how to move forward rather than because he unified the KSC. He nevertheless had an opportunity to reform Czechoslovak communism with unprecedented popular legitimacy. But who actually was Alexander Dubček? Born on November 27, 1921, Dubček's upbringing was highly unconventional and to some extent helps us understand his reformist streak. Aged just three, he moved with his parents to a commune in the newly formed Kyrgyz SSR in the Soviet Union. Though he would return to Czechoslovakia in 1938 and join the Communist Party, the commune's utopian ideals informed an idealist outlook which characterized many younger communists who joined the KSC leading up to, during, and immediately after the Second World War. He was undoubtedly a committed communist, but his unique experiences set him apart from members of the old guard, like Novotny, who were much more sympathetic to the Stalinist approach. While Dubček's rise undoubtedly represented a departure from the Novotny period, there was little indication early on that Dubček would enact as radical reforms as he did. Yet in April 1968, only 3 months after his appointment, he announced what he called the Action Program, better known now by the moniker Socialism with a Human Face. Dubček's policies inadvertently unleashed the discontent that had been building in Czechoslovakia since the 1950s, a great deal more discontent than had actually been expected. The action program broadly consisted of two key sets of reforms. The first addressed issues in the economic sphere. Otaszek's idea of a mixed economy was revived, and centralized control of some key sectors of the economy was ceded, while at the same time Dubček sought to diversify trade links with the West at the expense of trade with the Eastern Bloc. He also sought to pivot the economy towards more production of consumer goods as a means of pacification, much like Khrushchev had done in the USSR in the 1950s and what Erich Honecker would do in East Germany in the 1970s. To quote Dubček himself, quote, "Socialism cannot mean only liberation of the working people from the domination of exploiting class relations, but must make more provisions for a fuller life of the personality than any bourgeois democracy." Clearly, Dubček's action program rigorously tackled head-on the economic issues that had plagued Czechoslovakia, but the most consequential reforms were those that liberalized political expression. In an unprecedented move for an Eastern Bloc country, he almost completely lifted restrictions on freedom of speech, championed a multi-party electoral system, and wanted to change the constitution so that the National Assembly would become the key power broker in government rather than the Central Committee of the KSC. And the results? Well, in the words of Anna Stoneman, Dubček's reforms, quote, "gave rise to a brief 8-month period of utter freedom, characterized by hitherto censored dissemination and discussion of information." Political prisoners and previous purge victims, for example, formed the K-231 organization, which was named after the law under which they had been sentenced. K-231 represented committed non-communist party members and provided a platform for intellectuals to criticize the government. Equally significantly, the dissident writer Ludwig Vaculík published the 2,000 Words Manifesto, which urged Czechoslovaks to seize the moment and establish full democracy through mass agitation and organization. Despite the Pandora's box that Dubček's action program had opened, he remained confident that he could keep the KSC in control of Czechoslovakia. According to Kieran Williams, there were broadly four reasons for his certainty. First, Dubček believed that he had the support of Moscow and the entire Eastern Bloc would benefit from a reformed Czechoslovakia. Second, he thought Khrushchev's rule had made the Soviet Union a more tolerant hegemon. Third, there were no Soviet military units based on Czechoslovakia's territory, so the KSC believed they were immune from any intervention. Finally, he believed that Czechoslovakia's membership in the Soviet sphere afforded it greater flexibility to make radical changes in comparison to the West, where democratic systems were more consolidated. It's interesting to note this last point in particular, especially given the student revolts that were taking place across the world in 1968 at the same time as the Prague Spring. In the US, protests against the Vietnam War and civil rights violations were giving birth to increasingly radical movements like the Black Panthers. As we explored in our previous video on Mexico's Dirty War, Mexican students were also revolting against the ruling Partido Revolucionario Institucional, the PRI, demanding greater freedoms. Perhaps most notably, in France, up to 10 million workers were rioting in the streets against the modernist status quo of the post-war order. The main lesson of 1968, though, was that in almost all countries where protests were taking place, domestic movements were losing fervor or being violently suppressed. In Czechoslovakia, by contrast, Dubček believed that communism represented a civilizational alternative to capitalism that enabled greater flexibility. In his view, if democracy could exist under a socialist model, Czechoslovakia would provide a major challenge to capitalist democracies. Thus, while Dubček's confidence may seem strange in hindsight, to a certain degree it was rooted in reality. For example, fully 60% of Czechoslovaks supported the policies of the action program, compared to some Western countries where many interests still supported the status quo ante despite ongoing protests. A further 21% in Czechoslovakia believed that the reforms were not radical enough. With over 80% of the population seeking change, the appetite for reforms within the communist system was real and ostensibly possible in Dubček's mind. Despite Dubček's faith in his government's position, even before the action program had been put in place, Brezhnev had made his concerns clear. In March 1968, for example, Brezhnev invited Dubček to a meeting in Dresden and urged him to put the brakes on reforms. But Dubček refused. Later, on July 14th, the USSR met with other Warsaw Pact states in Warsaw to authorize the, quote, last resort of intervention if things went too far. On August 3rd, perhaps fatally, Dubček was called to Bratislava. Here, the Bratislava Declaration was signed by the USSR, Poland, East Germany, Hungary, and even Czechoslovakia itself, who agreed that the Soviet Union could intervene militarily if so-called, quote, bourgeois system was established. To Brezhnev, this bourgeois system meant any system which allowed the hegemony of the KSC to be legitimately challenged. All these developments came less than a year after Brezhnev's statement outlining that issues in Czechoslovakia were not the USSR's problem. So what had changed? Well, on one hand, it was of course the growing radicalism of the Prague Spring movement itself. Though Dubček did not wish to overthrow the communist system entirely, the reality was that allowing free speech had enabled radical views to become more mainstream. Brezhnev's view was that the successful radical reforms would create demand for changes in other communist states and risk toppling regimes entirely. Thus, an alternative communist model for Czechoslovakia threatened the stability of the USSR and the entire Eastern Bloc. On the other hand, Brezhnev's concerns about Czechoslovakia were compounded by developments elsewhere in the Soviet sphere of influence. Cracks in the unity of the Eastern Bloc had been evident for years. We're all familiar with the Stalin-Tito split of 1948, but other communist states were also moving away from Moscow's party line in the 1960s. Enver Hoxha's Albania had made a formal declaration of independence from Soviet influence in 1960, for example, while Nicolae Ceausescu's Romania did the same in 1964. Governance in both states subsequently became characterized by personality cults and an ideological orthodoxy that went far beyond that of the USSR. Given that Czechoslovakia had always been a closer ally of the Soviet Union than Yugoslavia, Romania, or Albania, for Brezhnev, the idea of a wayward Czechoslovakia was intolerable. With the Bratislava Declaration of August 1968, then, the fate of the Prague Spring and socialism with a human face was on a knife edge. Even though Dubček clearly thought he was acting within the confines of the socialist system, with the backing of his people, and even with Moscow's support, Brezhnev did not see things the same way. Intervention was still not inevitable following the Bratislava Declaration, but the USSR had made its position clear. Could the Prague Spring continue even if the radicalism of reformers was limited? Was there any way for Dubček to negotiate with Brezhnev? All this will be revealed in a future episode of this two-part series on the events of 1968 in Czechoslovakia. We hope you've enjoyed this episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future work, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have liberalized access to the bell button, thinking that you have the support of your imperial overlords, but not understanding that the bell button is really only for the selected few. Please consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, please remember that history is shades of gray and rarely black and white.